When you taste candy, you'll probably notice, if anybody's tasting candy right now, which I hope you are, that it's a little bit tart. I don't really have a sweet tooth. I have a fruit tooth. And so when you're distilling something that is so pleasurable and so primal, right, it's important to also have the tartness, the acidity, and the balance. And that kind of speaks to the art in candy making as well. So that acidity is mostly citric acid. We use a few different types of acid that have different flavor profiles. And the acid actually is what makes your tongue able to have the reaction on your taste buds. That chemical reaction that sends like a neurological impulse to your brain that says, oh my God, this is banana or this is strawberry. You gotta have the presence of an acid. So if we were to make a batch of candy and we forgot acid in the candy, you would have like a beautiful candy that tastes like nothing but sugar, no matter how much fruit extract we put in. So that's so when we work on the flavors, when we approach candy, we kind of have a little bit of, you know, science. You know, we think about chemical reactions, this and that, but we also think about how does the candy feel and how does it look. If you looked at your piece of candy, you might have noticed, like I said earlier, that there's a picture inside. Those candies on average are about 12 millimeters in diameter. And so one of the biggest challenges for me as a rock maker is to create an image that has meaning in a 12 millimeter canvas. And I can't blow it up. Maybe it's, I didn't use a PowerPoint presentation because candy doesn't really have a, doesn't really have the same value if you look at it. It has to be held and tasted. So the 12 millimeters is all we have. And so we kind of like take a banana and draw it out and then simplify it down to like the most basic form. Well, it's yellow and it's got a bit of a curve and it's maybe got one brown stripe in it to give the kind of illusion of maybe some depth, and that's it. There's no more detail. I can't make any more detail in it. There's just 12 millimeters, and if I put too much detail, it's gonna look fuzzy. It's gonna look kind of like it's lost or like it's too busy in there. So we take a very simplistic approach to making the designs inside, and it's a very traditional also process. So some of my designs that we do inside the candy are some that I've come up with, like the root beer mug, for instance, or the pomegranate. Some of the designs are about 300 years old, like the blueberry, and first appeared in Victorian England in like probably London, although it's most famous in Blackpool and Brighton now for these designs. So it's kind of fun to like look at this historical design and think, okay, well, how do I interpret this, or how do I take a pomegranate, a fruit that's maybe more popular now, or a kiwi fruit, something you didn't even have in England when this candy first came out, and give it the same type of aesthetic as the traditional rock. So we're kind of connected to the people who went before us as rock makers. Now, there's not a lot of people who do this. I'm one of three people making rock in Western Canada right now, and the other two people I taught. So it's kind of a, yeah. So it's kind of a lost art. You know, when you eat candy is one of the most probably fundamental things. Like, we saw Pikachu earlier, everybody knows who Pikachu is, right? But I can go to somewhere like super remote where nobody knows who Pikachu is, and they know what candy is. Candy is one of the most universal and most like widely accessible things in the world. And so the other side of candy is the manufacturing, the mass production of candy. And that's also part of the art form. When we design a candy, it has to be made in a way that it can be scaled up. Like, nobody wants to pay like $25 for like a piece of candy, right? It breaks down the access. The people who enjoy candy the most are children, and they have the least purchasing power. So you have to figure out a way, like, how do we bring something, an artistic medium, to someone who really can't like fund it at all, or is only willing to give a tiny, tiny, tiny amount of money. And that, once again, goes back to the simplicity of candy. It's sugar, it's flavor, it's design, and then the process is also engineered in a way that we can push as much as possible out to people. And that's, I find a lot of art in that. You know, there's a lot of folks who kind of feel like something mass-produced isn't really art. But to me, the challenges that are involved in creating a design that, not something that only a master can make, but somebody can come into the kitchen, I can sit there and in 3 or 4 days, they can make the design just as well as I can. That takes a huge amount of thought, and that's something that I find really kind of inspiring. So anyway, I have kind of a few chunks of like anecdotes basically about candy. I'm gonna share a couple more. But I really want to open it up because my favorite thing about candy is really kind of like demystifying it. So I'm hoping you guys will think of some questions. I'm going to answer a few that I really like with some science. One of my favorite questions about candy is, why do Pop Rocks fizzle? And it's really interesting. So Pop Rocks are mostly sugar, like all candy. But the active ingredients, what makes them kind of pop and sizzle in your mouth, is citric acid and calcium carbonate, baking soda, right? And so, or sodium bicarbonate, but anyhow, so baking soda and citric acid. And what happens is the citric acid is anhydrous, so it's not reactive. It can't like donate a hydronium ion in the sugar. It's all like, it's in a matrix of sugar, which is like, has like no water activity. A big part of why candy doesn't go bad. There's no water activity hardly in that hard sugar. So the reaction can't take place until it's in your mouth. And as soon as it's in your mouth, of course, the citric acid reacts with the baking soda and you get CO2, you get water, and you get a really weird ingredient called sodium citrate, which is actually what they use to flavor club soda. And it kind of has like a funky, tangy taste. So it's part of the flavor of Pop Rocks, but it's also a kind of an interesting byproduct of the reaction as well. And of course, the CO2 then is what gives you that fizzle. A little bit of CO2 will turn into carbolic acid on your tongue and also like create kind of new flavors as a different type of acid. Another one I think is really interesting, this is something that's brand new, is like, how do you make natural blue coloring? And it's super, super hard to do. All of our candies are all natural. So they're a little different than a lot of mass-produced candies. And in the past, we've used gardenia blue from the gardenia flower, and the FDA, apparently there was a huge industry scramble. Like, we'd read the industry candy magazines, like, how do we make blue? How do we make blue? How do we make blue? And the answer was really interesting. People started cultivating a strain of spirulina bacteria that when it's dried and powdered, it's a super bright, like, almost sky blue. And so it was amazing. It was like, it changed the whole natural candy world. This spirulina is hitting the market, everybody's going nuts. And so I was so excited to get a sample of this for the very first time. So I started to mix it into my sugar to test. And I noticed in the candy that the blue color was just fading and turning clear. And we realized that the heat that we work with, because it's hard crack sugar, our candy is the hottest candy that you would make. Heat determines how the sugar behaves. The harder the candy, the hotter the sugar. So our blue is just completely disappearing. So we actually had to mix it with water, and as the water would boil off, it would suck enough energy from the candy around it that it would stop the spirulina from breaking down, and we were able to use it. It was kind of a challenge. So anyway, I'll go ahead and open the floor up to anybody who wants to ask a question about candy, the science behind candy, how your favorite candy is made. I have one in the back, yes. Ah, that's a great question. How do they get the printing to say Blackpool Rock? You mentioned Blackpool Rock. That's kind of it was the last holdout of rock candy before the Industrial Revolution was about to totally destroy rock making. So when you make the letters in candy, right, you basically make a giant sushi roll out of molten sugar. Instead of letters like an A, right, something like this, you would actually make a brick with the cross-section of the letter throughout the brick. And then you would arrange those in a log of sugar, wrapped up, like I said before, like a sushi roll. And as you stretch that down, it'll shrink the design down into something more bite-sized. There's some videos online, if you Google or look on the back of your bag of candy and go to the website, there's some really neat videos if you want to see the process. But the thing that amazes me the most is that sugar it seems like it's infinitely stretchy. You can draw sugar down to the diameter of a human hair. And if you look at it in a microscope, you will still see whatever design, Blackpool Rock, or I sent out some Canada 150 candies inside. You'll see that design in every single piece. So that's kind of amazing. And actually, one of the neat science demonstrations we did with candy a couple years ago, as kind of like a science communication thing, in Tallahassee, where I'm from, used to be the world's largest magnet. Somebody built a bigger magnet somewhere, and we had to like take that off the Welcome to Tallahassee sign. It was the world's biggest magnet. It's an electromagnet that's cooled with these crazy semiconducting, or it's cooled with liquid nitrogen and liquid helium, but it has these crazy semiconducting ceramic wires inside of it that allow this magnet to be so powerful. And these wires are actually made just the same way we make our rock candy. They started with a big forget what they call it. I think they call it a slug. But it's basically a big block of very, very carefully arranged layers of ceramics and copper, because the ceramics are only like maybe, gosh, probably 1% of the diameter of the actual wire itself. There's a huge amount of copper, because if the cooling system were to fail, then the electricity passing through the, basically the superconductor would immediately become a resistor, and there'd be a massive amount of energy that's got to go somewhere. And that goes into the copper surrounding this superconductor. So they basically make a mix of superconductors and copper in the same way that we make our candy. And so I've done candy with little tiny gray strips of sugar that represented superconductors and a big block of yellow sugar that represented the copper, and drew it out in the magnet. You got to see kind of how these wires are made. Of course, when we draw out a piece of candy, we do just about a, maybe like I said, 100 feet of rope, give or take, on a batch. When they draw out a superconducting wire, they'll draw it out for kilometers to get it down to the right diameter. All right, do we have time for any more questions? I saw a bunch more hands up. Right here, yes? Yes, marshmallows are mostly made of air, starch, and gelatin, and sugar. Yeah, and there's a lot of vegan marshmallows, and actually, this is a really interesting story I have about marshmallows. So when I was doing some research, starting my candy company back in Florida, we were looking at other candy companies that had done successful crowdfunding platforms and stuff, and we found this marshmallow company that was doing vegan marshmallows. They weren't using gelatin, they were using agar or some other type of substance that was giving them the similar properties, a organic gel, as Ella would have said. And so they had a huge amount of fanfare, they raised a ton of money, and they sent out all of these samples to, you know, and gifts for their crowdfunding campaign to thousands of people. And they started getting emails back that the marshmallows were molding, and they hadn't fully tested. So just like a scientist tests and tests and tests every step of the way, looking for problems, keeping data, keeping immaculate records, a candy maker has to do the same thing. We're not just making a one-off, we're making a repeated process that's going to be delivered, and we have to know all the parameters in that process. And so if a marshmallow maker doesn't test, you might get moldy marshmallows. So every time you get a wonderful marshmallow that has no problems at all, you know that someone's done a lot of science to get it to you in that way. Anyone else have any other questions? Yes? That's an awesome question. So she asked, can all flavors be captured naturally? And the answer is not exactly, but we're creative in the candy world. A lot of, there's four big families of like flavors. There's esters, aldehydes, terpenes, and phenols. Anything that falls in those groups, there's pretty much a way to get. Like a lot of our flavors are dissolved in alcohols. But some of them, not so easy. Watermelon is one of the hardest flavors for us to get. And I would find, because you just can't get something that is heat stable and shelf stable out of a watermelon. That's gonna have enough flavor to have an impact in a piece of candy. So we searched and we searched and we searched to try to find what was a good watermelon flavor, and we actually ended up going with a cucumber-based extract. We blended it with a few other flavors, and it was an emulsion, so it was actually solids suspended in water with an emulsifier. And that was our secret. And it took me 6 years to find that watermelon. And no one else makes candy with that particular extract. And I will never tell where that comes from or who I get it from. That is a secret. Oh, yeah. Yeah, sorry. If anyone has any more questions, attack me later.